Our first speaker today is Jeanne Brown. Jeanne is the mother of Alex Brown and the director of the RAB Foundation. RAB stands for Remember Alex Brown. The RAB Foundation is created by Extreme Makeover Home Edition. Their story has been featured on Oprah, The Mike Huckabee Show, and The Today Show, as well as hundreds of local news stations, newspapers, magazines, and radio. They have traveled across the United States sharing their story with teens and adults in hope of saving lives. Please help me in giving Mrs. Jeanne Brown a very warm Muleshoe welcome.
Good afternoon. Hey, that's a good mic. I can wake some kids up with this one. Are y'all glad school is nearly over? Oh, yeah. You know what? I want to personally tell you, your teachers are more glad school is nearly over than you are.
Yeah.
All right. I'm from a small town in West Texas called Wellman. Anybody know where Wellman is? Have you been through it? Anybody been through Wellman? We have a few that have been through there. If you blink, you miss it, don't you? Yes, small town. We have a school, six-man football. Yeah, get you some of that. The whole area around Wellman, if you drive around, is like a mile and a half. There's less than 200 people in that live in Wellman. Whenever college starts in the fall, there'll be, right now there's about 197. There'll be about 194 because we have three seniors that are leaving to go to college. All right, I am here to talk to you today about texting and driving. How many of you are really excited to hear this? That's what I thought. Thank y'all for being honest. Before you start, I have a few questions for y'all. Can y'all be honest with me?
Yeah.
All right, thank you. I'm not to that question yet. We'll get there. How many of you have a license and you're legal driver? Fantastic, great. All right, how about this one? How many of you do not have a license to drive, but you drive anyway? That would be everybody else. No taking notes. We're calling this a safe zone. No taking notes. All right, how about this one? Really, no taking notes. I will find you. All right. How many of you like to go a little faster than you're supposed to behind the wheel? Uh-huh. Policemen do too. When I was in college, the highway patrol tried to recruit me. You know what their selling point was? You can go as fast as you want without getting a ticket. I was like, no thanks. How many of you, when you get in your car to go somewhere with your passenger or a driver, maybe you're just driving around the school parking lot, but you don't put your seatbelt on? Anybody ever go anywhere without their seatbelt on? Uh-huh. We had someone holding their hand up back there. We went to lunch and we got ready to leave and the Suburban was beeping and I'm like, who does not have their seatbelt on? It was this gentleman that's going to be talking to you in a minute. All right. One more question. How many of you, when you're behind the wheel, have either used your cell phone to place a call or to answer a call? You've texted someone, read a text message, Facebook, Twitter, anybody? Okay? Well, thank you for being honest. I really just wanted to see if y'all were like normal kids everywhere else I go. Gosh, you're just like everyone else. We've all done it. Some people still do it. I used to text and drive all the time. I'm a technology teacher. So it's like, we can multitask anything, right? No. Let me tell you about taking my kids to school when they were little. I'd be driving to school, and I'd be texting my friend. I only had one. That's why it's only one friend. I text my friend on the way to school. I'm as bad as y'all are. I was going to see her in a few minutes. She taught with me, but I had to text her on the way. And I would be texting away, and I would hit the rumble strips over here. You know where rumble strips are?
Yeah.
Okay? So I'd hit them, and then I'd straighten up, and I would act like I did it on purpose just to scare my kids. I'm like, that scared you, didn't I? They were just like glaring at me. So I'd straighten up, then I'd start texting again. Well, there was one day that my daughter started screaming at me, Alex. She said, Mom, you're going to kill us. And I looked up, thinking I was fixing to hit somebody. No, I was just going across the road. Nobody was there. Any of y'all ever do that? Yeah? Okay, well, here's the deal. I always thought that I could multitask and text and drive, and it's no big deal. Well, my daughter, Alex, looked at me one day. She had her license. She said, Mom, how come it's okay for you and Dad to text and drive, but y'all tell me I can't do it? Well, when she asked my husband that, y'all know what Dad said, right?
Do what I say, not what I do.
Right? Well, I am the school teacher, so I have to explain, so she will learn. Wow. So I tell her, Alex, honey, I have been driving since before you were born. My knee has more experience driving than you do. When you become an adult and you're on your own, if you want to text and drive, that's your business. But while you're under my roof, how do you do it? What does it say? Do as I say and follow my rules. Do your parents ever tell you that? How does that work for you? You ignore them because we learn by example. And my daughter learned by my example. And on November the 10th, 2009, my daughter Alex made a choice to text and drive on the way to school. Now, before I tell you what happened to Alex, I want to tell you a little bit about her. She was an amazing young lady, and I'm not just saying that because I'm mom. People that knew her will tell you she was. She was a leader in school and in the youth group at church. She loved FFA. She was an officer, had been to state contests. She was also an award-winning actress on stage. She loved to sing. She was in choir. She played the saxophone in band. She was also very smart. She carried a 4.0 in the college classes she took in high school, and by the end of her senior year, she would have been a sophomore in college when she went. Her goal was to be the next Megyn Kelly on Fox News, and she had everything lined out. She was taking classes where she could learn to debate, she could research well, she knew what she believed, and she could back it up with facts. And I was a proud mom, because she was going to go to South Plains, get her associate's degree in broadcast journalism, then she wanted to go to WT where she would get her bachelor's. And eventually she hoped to get to New York City as an intern at Fox News. But you know, the choices that we make can sometimes change everything about what happens in the future. In the morning of November the 10th, 2009, Alex had just started her senior year. That was the day basketball season started. First scrimmage against La Mesa. And she was excited. I had to be at school at 7:30, but on Tuesdays and Thursdays, she didn't have to be there until 9:30 for her college class. So I left her in bed. I thought this is a good experience for her to have to get up and get herself ready because she's fixing to go to college and I won't be there to wake her up. So I got up, took her little sister, my daughter Katrina, took her to school, went to my job. A little after 9:30, one of the teachers came to find me. Hey, is Alex supposed to be at school today? Yes. Well, she's not here. So I call her, she doesn't answer her phone. I text her, she doesn't reply. That's kind of was like normal because she'd have her phone on silence. But I knew she would eventually see it and get in touch with me, and it was all good. A couple of minutes passed, I hadn't heard from her. I called my husband, I said, did Alex oversleep this morning? He said, no, she was up and ready for school when I left. She probably stayed on Facebook too long. And she did. Do you know we can check that? She did. When we couldn't find her, I went to the office and I told him I needed to leave, that we couldn't get in touch with Alex. So I left campus, and as I headed home, there's two roads that go from Wellman, where we live, to Seagraves, where I was teaching at my kids' wake school. One's the nice wide four lane. It was 70 miles an hour, now 75 miles an hour. That's the road she's supposed to take. Because if she has car trouble or something, there's lots of traffic. She can get help. The other road's a narrow county road. It's hidden from the main road. I've always told her not to take it because I knew it was dangerous. I grew up in Wilmington, and I knew about kids that had wrecks out there. People don't find them because they can't see them on the main road. As I got ready to leave school, I was just praying. I don't know which road do I need to take? And I just felt in my heart I needed to go down the county road. So I headed down that county road, and I was speeding. The farther I got from school, the more I panicked. And as I was driving, I saw something out in the middle of a field that I did not recognize. And I finally realized that was Alex's truck. And I slammed on my brakes and I got out of my car and I ran out there and I'm like, Alex, what did you do? She wasn't in the truck. and I couldn't find her. And I was, my mind just went racing. And she must have gone for help. But she doesn't even know who lives around here. I've got to go find her because she could be hurt and pass out. And then something bad could happen to her. I got to find her. And as I was walking around trying to figure out what to do, I heard something. And as I went around the truck and looked over, I saw my daughter laying in the weeds in the dirt. She was going in and out of consciousness and making noises. I called 911, but it took several tries just to dial the numbers right because I was shaking so bad. After I got off the phone with 911, I called my husband to let him know I found her. He was in our own business, and a friend of his drove him to the scene. He arrived just before the helicopter did. We got to walk her part of the way to the helicopter. They said, say something positive and encouraging to her. So we did. And as my friend drove us to the hospital, the helicopter driver, pilot, called me back and he goes, she was alive when we got here. I'm thinking, duh, she's not going to die. Why do people keep telling me this? Because I had several comments about it. I'm like, she's going to be fine. So we get to the hospital, we walk into the emergency room, the doctor comes out to meet us and he said, she's probably not going to make it. I need to know what you want us to do. And I looked at him and I said, you saved my daughter. You saved my daughter. Because Alex had a purpose in this world. It seemed like hours had passed. I don't know how much time it was. The surgeon comes back with another doctor with him and they sit us down and they say, look, we've done this and this and this. We've lost her several times on the operating table. We need to know what you want us to do. Because at that point, I was like, in my head, I was like, I'm so selfish. I'm trying to keep her here, and she's not going to be Alex if she stays. She wasn't going to be okay. And my husband and I, we didn't even talk about it. He was sitting right there. But at the same time, we looked at the doctor, and we both said, let her go. Let her go. They went to get her cleaned up so we could tell her bye. My parents, my brothers and sisters, my cousins, our cousins. As we waited for him to get her cleaned up, my husband looked at me and he said, you know what we have to do? Usually I can read his mind. Not that time. And I just looked at him. What are we supposed to do? He said, we got to put a truck on a trailer. We got to go tell these kids what happens when you text and drive. And that was the first time I'd been told she'd been texting. But what we found out from the investigating officer was that she'd been texting three friends that day on her cell phone. Nothing important, but she was texting them. He said she was going about 75 on a 60-mile-an-hour road. And as she was texting her friends, she went off the road to the right. And everything happened so fast. She didn't even know what was happened. It happened so quickly. She went off the road. The truck rolled one time. Once. But Alex did not wear her seatbelt that day. And because she didn't, she came out the passenger side window. And as the truck completed the roll, it landed on top of a 110-pound daughter and crushed her. That's why they couldn't save her. And then when I found it, the truck was sitting right side up. And I know that's really sad, and I cry. It's been nearly 7 years, and it's still hard. But I'm not here to make y'all sad, or I don't want y'all feeling sorry for me, or crying. I don't even want you crying. I think it's a sad story. But Alex's story isn't the point. The point is, it didn't have to happen. If different choices had been made, Alex would be here today. And I want y'all to understand the consequences that come along with some of the choices that we make. Because a lot of times, we do what seems like fun, not realizing how dangerous it can be if things go wrong. As I begin researching to come up with things to help you understand why it's dangerous to text and drive, so that maybe you'll make a choice not to, I came across this. I thought it was interesting. There's three main types of distractions that we have to deal with when we're driving. And it doesn't matter if you're a new driver or if you're an old driver like me. The first thing you have to deal with is a visual distraction. That occurs when you take your eyes off the road. Maybe you're looking over here, you're looking over there, looking in the rearview mirror, seeing how awesome you look. But you're distracted visually. The second kind is manual. That's when you take your hands off the wheel. Where are our hands supposed to be when we drive? Where at? I heard somebody say it. 10 and 2, I heard it, 10 and 2. I get so irritated. My baby, he's a senior this year, she graduates tomorrow night. She'll drive and she's like this. On the bottom of the steering wheel. Like Katrina, if you have a blowout, I'm gonna hurt you. If you survive, because you're gonna roll. She doesn't do the 10 and 2. So is she manually distracted? Oh yeah. One hand on the wheel, you're distracted because you don't have both hands on the wheel. What's your other hand doing? It could be texting. It could be just in the radio. It could be putting on makeup, girls. Okay? But that's a manual distraction. You're not paying attention to driving. You're paying attention to what the other thing is you're doing. Cognitive. That's something we don't usually think about. Cognitive is actually what you're thinking about. Okay? You're taking your mind off of what you're doing. You're daydreaming. Maybe you had a fight with your parents on the way to school. You're going back to the fight and you're telling your parents off. You're not thinking about driving. You know how I know this stuff? I remember doing it. Okay? So, these are the three types of distractions that we deal with. Everybody deals with them. So let's think for a minute. Have you ever been walking through the house, school? I don't know what your school policy is on cell phones, but we'll just pretend it's okay to text in the school. You're walking through and you're texting. And you slow down, and you finally stop to finish your text message? Anybody else ever do that? Why do you do that? And why do you slow down? Tell me why.
Because you're focused on the text.
Okay. Anybody else? Oh, now everybody's going, mm-mm, I don't have a clue. Tell me why.
Because you're so concentrated on the text, you're not thinking about walking anymore.
Very good.
Thank
you. I forget. Y'all are young. Y'all don't worry about getting hurt. I'm not worried about focusing on my text. I'm worried about running into furniture. Those shins are a lot more tender than they were when I was your age. It hurts a lot more to kick stuff. I hate having my toenail peeled back because I run into furniture and kick something. It hurts. But guys, if you're worried that you can't pay attention to walking while you're texting, and I'm worried I'm going to get a toenail hurt when I'm walking, why do we think we can get in a car, set the cruise at 75, 80, and not get hurt texting and driving when we can't walk across the room doing it? It just doesn't make sense. You know, we talk a lot about don't drink and drive, don't drink and drive. Buzz driving is drunk driving. Okay? If you are legally intoxicated at a 0.08 blood alcohol level, you're 4 times more likely to be involved in a wreck. Now understand, that's not falling down, puking on yourself drunk. That's buzzed driving. You're 4 times more likely to be involved in a wreck. Well, the crazy thing is, if you're talking on your cell phone, and driving, whether you're holding that puppy up here or whether you're using a hands-free device, you're 4 times more likely to be involved in it. Talking on the phone and driving is as dangerous as drunk driving. I don't know many people that would see a drunk coming out of a bar and go, "Dude, I want to ride with you." But we're fine with somebody talking on the phone while we're in the car with them. No, put it down. You're driving. When they started researching, they found out about texting and driving, 23 times more likely to be involved in a wreck than a drunk driver. insane. There's several people that have done this over the years, and they're having to live with the consequences of those choices. Reggie Shaw is one of them. He was 18 when he had his wreck. Killed these two scientists in Utah. He has to live with it. He'll tell you it's not worth texting and driving, what he has to live with every day, knowing what he did. This is Matt Mitchell. He's an ex-highway patrolman in Illinois. Ex, not by choice. He was responding to a scene, going over 120 miles an hour, talking to his girlfriend on his cell phone, working on his laptop, lost control of his car, went across the median, and hit the car of these two young ladies, sisters. All they were doing was going to the mall to shop. But they're dead. He's hurt. For life. Tim Christensen was riding his motorcycle one day, just out for fun. Someone on their phone didn't see him in that truck. He's gone. Nicole Johnson had just gotten a job and was headed to work. Texted her friend and went into oncoming traffic. They used the jaws of life to get her out, but it was too late. 16. This is Alexis from Pennsylvania. We were actually in Pennsylvania when she had this wreck. We're fixing to do a presentation at school, and I get an email from someone. Head cheerleader, dating the captain of the football team. It's like Barbie Goes America, right? She was texting her boyfriend, telling him how excited she was to cheer for him at the playoff game. She hit a tree, was killed instantly. This happened in Lockhart, Texas. This man was out, again, just riding his bicycle. Truck didn't see him. Plowed over him and he's gone. That's not the only ones. There's lots of stories. Right after we started doing this, I had a lady get in touch with me and said, thank you for telling the kids what's going on. My husband was headed to Lubbock one day, rear-ended a truck. We could not figure out what had happened. It killed him. We could not figure out what happened. When they took him out of the car, they had to dig his cell phone out of his chest because he was texting. See, there's a reason. I mean, it's not just that we're uncoordinated or we're stupid that we can't text and drive. It's because our brains work a certain way. It's the way they were designed to work. And we can't. Our brain, honestly, cannot multitask. When we're driving, the same part of our brain that we used to read those text messages, figure out what they say, and then respond, is the same part of our brain that helps us decide how fast to go, helps us know when we need to step on the brake, or to turn on a turning signal. That part of the brain, it can focus on driving, or it can focus on texting, but it can't focus on both. It has to make a choice. And if you're driving and then you pick up your cell phone, what is your brain choosing to do? It's choosing to pay attention to the cell phone. A study was done by Allstate. They found that on any given day, an average of 11 teenagers are killed in car crashes. The number one reason for a car crash is distracted driving. It's not an experience, it's distracted driving. The number one distraction that we have in our cars now, it's our phones, it's electronic devices. And I can promise you that none of the kids that died that day, including Alex when she died, ever said, I'm going to get in my car today, and I'm going to text, and I'm going to die. That was never their goal. They all said, that's not going to happen to me. I will put money on it. I know my daughter did. Because on Friday, before her wreck, my husband caught her texting as she left the house. And he ran out there to stop her. He was totally prepared to break that cell phone. But Alex and her daddy... Daddy, please no. So he didn't. But he did tell her, if you don't quit texting and driving, you're going to have a wreck. Do you know she didn't say, oh, Daddy, I know you're right. She didn't say that. You know what she said? Dad, no, I'm not. because that's truly what she believed. Friday night, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, I say goodbye to my daughter. Guys, I'm not here to tell you don't take some drugs. It wouldn't do any good. Brad, you're going to do what you want to do. But I do hope that through this presentation, there's some seeds that are planted in your heart that you realize, I don't need to do this. I need to be here for my future. I have a couple of videos I'm going to show you. One is my husband. He's not able to travel with me anymore. The other is my daughter, Katrina. Like I said, she's graduating tomorrow night. This was from when she was in sixth grade. So I'm going to show those to y'all, and then I will come up and finish up my presentation.
Technology. Probably everybody out there's got a cell phone of some sort, or most people. You know, some of you have an iPhone, some of you have Droids, some of you have Samsung, LGs, whatever you got, you know. Even an old guy like me has one. I use a Crackberry. I like my Crackberry because it does everything I want it to do, you know. I can read emails, text messages, phone calls, Facebook, Twitter, take pictures, Google, whatever. It does a lot of stuff I don't even care if it does. But the bottom line is everybody uses technology, but this little piece of technology is not very dangerous. And I bet you want to know why I call it a Crackberry, don't you? Well, I call it a Crackberry because there's a lot of people out there, some of you out there, just as addicted to this thing as a crackhead is to crack. You know what I mean? I mean, you can't put it down. You know who you are. You got it right now between your legs or down beside you. Well, no, not me, man. I got this. You know what I mean. You just can't do without it. But this little piece of technology is not very deadly by itself. I mean, I can't hurt anybody. If I was there, I threw it up there as hard as I could and hit somebody in the head. But all you get is a knot on the head, you know. Chase me around a little bit, whatever, you know. But why are so many people dying from these things? Why will 16 people die today because of this? And out of 11 of those are people your age, people are teenagers. And that may just be some numbers to you, but I'll tell you what it means to me. It means that 11 sets of parents, after some horrific news today, after a sleepless night tonight, they'll have to go and plan a funeral for their teenager tomorrow. A funeral they never planned because of a text message or a phone call. So the problem lies is the choice. The choice to use this behind the wheel. You have to make that choice. You see, that's what I want to talk to you about for a second. But it's about choices. It's, hold up. No, y'all don't tune me out just yet. I know you get tired of your parents and your teachers and everybody, you know, telling you, make good choices. I got that, okay? But this is a choice that's so important that it can mean whether you get home today or not. You see, you're the only one that can make that choice. You have to make the choice that, is that text message so important that I have to get it right now while I'm driving? Is that going to make me so much more important that I've got to get it right now? I can't wait till I get to where I'm going. The deal is you can wait, but it's your choice. You have to decide how important that text message is. If it's worth endangering you, everybody in your car, everybody around you, is that text message? It probably says something like, well, so important that you have to get it in while you're driving. You know, see, every choice you make every day is important. No matter how big the choice is or how small that choice is, every choice is important because there's only two things that happen for every choice that you make. You either reap the benefits of that choice or you suffer the consequences. And when you make those bad choices, the same choices that my daughter made, you're not the only one that suffered the consequences. Your whole family, your friends, the whole community will suffer the consequences. So you see, you have to make that choice. And I didn't make the right choices either. You know, even after, I'll tell you a quick story. Even after I buried my 17-year-old daughter with such a bright future, I caught myself reading emails and answering phone calls and writing stuff down because, you know, I made the choice that I was important. You know, I was a businessman. I had to take care of business. I didn't have time to stop. And one day while I was driving down the road, I was close to having my phone right here and writing stuff down and weaving on the road, hitting the rumble strips on this side, and I'd straighten up, riding with my leg, and I heard the rumble strips again, and they were coming, it was a different sound, so I looked up, and I was in the middle of the road, and somebody was trying to pass me, And I swerved over and was, I pushed them on to the rumble strips. And of course, I straightened up and everything and got it all gathered up before anything happened. And then I let them by, you know, I told them sorry. And, you know, they went by and told me I was number one.
Number two.
You know, but the bottom line is I had to pull over because I thought, how stupid is that? Oh, I wasn't texting like my daughter was or those teenagers do, you know. But I was doing the same thing, the exact same thing. I was paying so much attention to my phone and what I and my business while I was driving that I completely disregarded safety. But anyway, teenagers have their own business. You know, whether it's just talking to your friends or planning what you're going to do this weekend or some of your girls asking, what are you wearing or something like that, you know. So I'll give you some examples, you know. Maybe you're not emailing or trading stock or whatever yet all the time while you're driving, but you have your own business. I'll give you an example. Let's say a couple of you, maybe one of you senior guys got a new ride, got a new truck or a new car for graduation. It's a pretty good day, right? So you're out in the driveway shining up your new car, getting ready to go drive around, show it off, go pick up your buddy. You're getting your new car, and you got your ceiling back just right, you got your cool shades on, maybe got your favorite cap, turn around backwards, plug your iPod in, whatever, and find your playlist, just to head down the street. You know, it's a pretty good day, man. You're driving along, yeah, it's a good day. So, yeah, this is mine. So you go pick up your friend, and he gets in, and he's checking out your ride, you know, and, hey, man, clean your feet before you get in here. Come on, let's go. Let's go show this baby off. So you and your friend are driving around, having a great time on top of the world, talking about your freedom you're about to experience at the end of the year when you graduate, college life, whatever you're talking about. It's a great day, showing off your new ride. Your phone goes off. You reach in your pocket and you get it. And maybe it's that girl from another town or another school or something, you know. You look at it and it says, Tiffany. So your car starts beating real fast. And I know you got it. You get a little more distracted. You probably get the big hit, so you got to do that mirror check. You know, oh yeah, I knew she could resist on this day. What's up, girl? You finna get out skipping because I'm finna go get Tiffany. So you're texting her back and you run that red light, or you miss that curve, run that stop sign. There's a truck coming. Bottom line is, it was a normal day. You're on top of the world and talking about your future or whatever. And in an instant, because you were paying so much attention to your phone, it's over. That's how fast it happens. And nobody is exempt from that. Not even me. No one. And, you know, the girls, you know, I picked on the guys, and y'all were probably laughing a little bit. I don't know. But now I'm going to pick on you, because I can. Because you may be a little more distracted than the guys. Yeah. You know why? Because you talk more. Yeah, I know. I had a hassle of them. I know these things, okay? So, you know, and I know you probably didn't even have to go anywhere to pick up your friend, right? Right. You know why? Because she's already in the car with you. You know how I know that? Because you don't even go to the bathroom by yourself. So why would you go drive anywhere by yourself? So anyway, you and your friend are driving around. And she's talking 300 miles an hour. You know, that's a little more distracting anyway. She's over there talking and you're trying to listen and so look where you're going. And that's without your cell phone going off. And she's over there talking like, you know, something like, oh my goodness, did you see Brittany today? She didn't even have her makeup on. I can't believe she came to school like that. Ew, I just don't know. So you're over there going, oh, no, and so your cell phone goes off, right? So you reach down there and console over your little camera and you pick up your new iPhone with a pink cover with the rhinestones on it. It's just so precious. Mom, I gotta have it. So anyway, you pick it up and your eyes get big and your friend says, who is it? And you say, oh my goodness, it's Bradley. I just knew he was going to text me. He is so hot. Anyway, so you start texting him back, you know, and same thing happens to you. You're on top of the world one second, having a great time with your friend, driving around, doing what you do. The next minute, you're in that stop sign because you're looking at your phone. And it's over for you too. You know, because you decided to pay more attention to your phone, because you were so under the influence of your social life behind the wheel, that your day's done. You see what I mean? There's enough dangers out there without adding a cell phone to it. You know, and I know, you know, we share a lot of these statistics that we get from universities that do these studies, and the Secretary of Transportation's office, the Ray LaHood, they do these studies and they get people to do these studies, and we share these numbers and these statistics with you so you'll know something about how bad it really is. But there's a lot of stuff that you'll never see any statistics on, because the only way you will is you have to experience a tragic loss like we did. If you continue to text and drive and you have your wreck and you do not make it, well, your family is left here on this earth with daily reminders of the day you die. Like every time they see an ambulance, guess what day they think of? Every time they drive by a cemetery or have to pull over for a funeral procession, guess what day they relive in their mind? You know, they can't even go on vacation for the rest of their life without driving along up in the mountains or wherever you go, to the lake or whatever, and you see these little crosses and monuments people put up on the side of the road when people die. Every time your mom or your dad's driving on vacation and they see those, they're going to think of the day you died. For the rest of their days on this earth, because you thought you could text and drive better than anybody else, it's not going to happen to you. They can't even go visit somebody in the hospital without fighting back the tears, walking down that hallway, trying to find that room number, because in their mind, they're reliving that day that you died there. So that's everything you put at risk, you know. You see, it shouldn't be an option for parents to have to bury their kids. We know growing up that by the time you get to high school, you figured out that someday you're going to have to bury your parents, right? That's part of life. We know that. It's a sad day, but we're usually somewhat prepared for that. But when you get that backwards, when you switch that around, it messes everything up. Did you know that the divorce rate for parents who bury their kids is 75%? That's what you're putting your family at risk for every time you pick up that cell phone. You see, it should be an option for us to have to bury our kids. But every time you pick up that cell phone behind the wheel, whether you do it selfishly or instinctively, you put all those options into play. And it's 23 times more likely that it's going to happen to you. And it's 23 times more likely, if you continue this habit, that your parents are going to get that phone call. And it's 23 times more likely that your parents are going to go to the scene of your crash and stand outside an ambulance just for later to watch them wheel you by on a gurney with a lifeless stare and load you on a helicopter. Yeah, I know, you got this, right? It's going to happen. That happens to other people. You think it's like my daughter did. She can text behind her back, text in her pocket. It's not going to happen to me. But it did. So it's 23 times more likely that if you continue this habit, that the last thing your parents get to do for you on the day you have your wreck is they get to, after they clean you up a little bit, they get to go on that trauma unit and hold your hand and watch you die. You see, that's the reality of texting and driving. I didn't make that up. I didn't read that in a book. I didn't watch that on TV. That was some hours out of one day of our life that changed it forever. So today when you go home, the next time you get in your car or whatever, your cell phone goes off and you instinctively reach down there to pick it up and look at it. Before you do, ask yourself this question. Ask yourself, am I willing to trade my life for some words on a phone? I know the answer. I hope you figure it out.
Hey guys, my name is Katrina Brown. I'm in the sixth grade and I'm 11 years old. As most of y'all know already, I lost my dear sister, Alex, on November 10th, 2009. And I would just like to share with y'all guys how it is for people that are younger than you. Okay, so y'all have heard about people having accidents. Okay, if y'all thought about having a car wreck, how many of y'all would really think about your younger siblings first? Really? I know I wouldn't. I would think about my parents and my grandparents, my aunts, my friends. I would probably never think of my younger siblings. And it really impacts them. It impacts them a lot. It will change their life forever. I know mine already has. When y'all text and drive, it's really just as bad as drinking and driving, you know? I hear lots of stories about people that drink and drive, people that text and drive and have been in a wreck. You know, I don't really think about it. But, you know, I should, because their family is having to go through what I'm going through. Okay. I just want to let you know you are a role model. Whether you know it or not, you're a role model. Whether you're the geekiest kid in school or the most popular kid in school. And just for y'all to know that y'all are a role model. And if y'all are in a car wreck and because of texting and driving and your people that you're a role model to find that out at school, it's going to be hard on them, and they're not going to know what you died from because they're too small to understand. And then they'll go off and do it and possibly have a wreck themselves, not knowing. So when they get older, you can share that message with them, and you can be a witness to them, not by just showing Jesus through you. It's hard really going through the day. I know if I didn't have a relationship with God, I wouldn't be able to get through this, but I do. And I learned most of what I know about God is not only through church, but through Alex. She's an amazing girl. She was a good person. And I was just at school one day when my counselor went in a big hurry, you know, to get me out of class. I didn't know why. They said that someone was going to take me out to lunch. I didn't know what was happening. But they were in a big hurry, and then I was told by my aunt that Alex had been in a wreck. And I felt like a million people just punched me in the stomach. I didn't know how bad it was. I didn't know anything that was happening, and I tried to stay positive on the way to Lubbock, but really, I think that all I wanted to do was cry. My aunt told me that she was rushed from a helicopter. I don't know about all these things, so I thought, you know, it's fine. Everyone's rushed in a helicopter if they're far away from Lubbock, right? No. And so we were there, and then picture and that you're in my shoes. You're 11 years old. You've never had someone this close to you die before. And the doctor that's working on your sister that is dying tells you that she's probably not going to survive and doesn't even... All I did was just fall into my jacket and start crying. And later that day, my dad came in and took my hand. I was playing a game on an iPhone, so, you know, I was occupied. But my dad came in, and I thought, yay, Alex is okay, I'm going to get to go see her now. But instead, he didn't walk straight. He turned to her chair. Like, oh, no, this can't be good. This can't be good. No, she didn't die. She didn't die. She didn't die. And then he whispered in my ear, Alex went to go be with Jesus. And I just busted out and cried on his shoulder. But really, what I wanted to do was bust out of that door and scream to go find my sister, because I knew she wasn't dead. I knew she wasn't, even though she was, because I think about her every day. And can't really bear to think of the thought I think about, and it gets worse and worse. I think about it every day, and it gets worse and worse every day. And don't do this to your younger siblings and your younger relatives, the people that look up to you. Don't do this to them. Don't make them suffer like Alex has made me. I mean, she didn't do it on purpose. Of course not. She wasn't like that. She wasn't that kind of person. But she made a stupid decision. Now I'm having to suffer for it. You know, she's on some
stuff. And it's been hard and sad. And I wonder, Alex class would be 24. She would be 25 in December on her birthday. And I just wonder what she would be doing with her life now. You know, there's some irony in what happened with Alex's wreck. I told you she was thrown out of the truck. Well, they found her cell phone. This is it. It is literally held together with super glue. My husband had to super glue a screw in it because she just took it everywhere and always dropped it. It's one of those that was free with the 2-year contract. It's kind of like. But they found this cell phone. Any guesses where it was? I can't hear you. Yeah, I'm. Okay, in her pocket. Anybody else? In her hand? In the truck, in the seat? It was still in the truck. It still worked. We finally had it disconnected. But do you get the irony in that? Cell phones can be replaced, guys. She was getting a new one. The contract was up and she wanted a new one. I said, Alex, if you'll wait until you go to college, I'll get you a brand new smartphone. So that's how old it was. They'd just come out with smartphones. I said, I will go get you. She wanted an Apple. I will go get you. I'm not Apple. She said, I will go get you an Apple iPhone. Okay? And she said, okay. So she was making do with this one. And it still worked after that wreck. But my daughter didn't work after that wreck. I hope you understand how valuable and important your life is. I know getting phone calls and text messages and being mentioned on Twitter and Facebook and whatever else apps y'all use now, because I know there's a lot more. I know that makes you feel special. It makes you feel important, like people are thinking about you and care about you, and that's a good feeling, isn't it? But guys, there's nothing you're going to get over your cell phone. Not a phone call, text message, Facebook comment, tweet, nothing that you're going to get over your cell phone that actually makes you more valuable than you already are. Each one of you has been designed and created for a very special purpose. Something that only you can fulfill in this world. But just like Alex, the choices that you make can keep that from happening. When y'all get ready to leave in a few minutes, they're going to be handing out a paper in the back if you want it. It's a pledge. It's a contract you make with yourself. It simply says that you understand the importance of safe driving and you choose to be safe and not text while you're driving. And you choose to always wear your seatbelt. And I hope y'all took the time at lunch to go look at Alex's truck out there. And if you did, hopefully you saw, the driver's side is in great shape. And she had her seatbelt on and stayed in the driver's seat where she belonged. She could have survived that wreck. Seatbelts save lives. I know they're not always comfortable. They chafe. They wrinkle my clothes. It's not cool. But it saves lives. It saved my life this month. Because a guy turned right in front of me, not out of the driver's lane, out of his left lane, turned right in front of me. And I could not miss him. And if I had not had my seatbelt on, I would have gone into that steering wheel. And it would have hurt. And if you look, my truck still crunched. I hadn't had time to fix it. But it saves lives. And guys, your life is worth saving. But I know some of you are going to choose to continue because I'm old. I'm stupid. I mean, honestly, that's what some of y'all are sitting there thinking. I'm not going to lie to you. You may not like the truth, but I'm going to tell you the truth. And so I just ask that if you're choosing to go ahead and text and drive and be distracted behind the wheel, would you at least let your parents know that's what you're doing? Because you may think it's none of their business, but reality is, when you have that wreck, who has to clean up the mess? Your parents. They're going to have to either pay doctor's bills, ambulance, because an ambulance will have to be called if you have a wreck. They may have to pay for your funeral. And they have a right to know. See, Alex's medical bills. She's dead. The ambulance was a volunteer ambulance. She was airlifted to Lubbock. Only a few hours in UMC. There was over $150,000. I'm a school teacher. I had never seen $150,000 at once, ever. If we had not had insurance, I figured it up. If we had not had insurance, it would take like over 4 years of my life to pay it off if I just used my paycheck to pay it. That's a lot. So what about your family? Does your family have health insurance for you so when you have that wreck and you have to go to the hospital, insurance takes care of it so they're not out all that money? Do they have a life insurance policy for you? You know, so they can pay for that funeral that's about $15,000 or more, depending on what they want done at the funeral. And parents want a nice funeral. I know that sounds weird, a nice funeral. But see, that's one of the last things we get to do for you because you chose to text and drive. And parents want to be able to do that. I know of a family that couldn't do that because they couldn't afford a funeral. Anybody in here like to go shopping? We got some shopaholics? The girls raising their hands. There's a few guys that are brave. I know guys like to shop. They just don't want to admit it. But let me make this suggestion. If you're going to continue to be distracted behind the wheel, next time you go shopping, run by the monument shop and pick out a headstone so your parents don't have to. Because that's hard. What do you want on your headstone, guys? I'm not trying to scare you. This is reality. When our Texas government is in a session in Austin, I go down there to try to get a law passed to make it against the law to text and drive. You are welcome. And every year, as families come, there's always about five or six new families that join us because they just lost somebody that year because of texting and driving. So it's real. So what do you want on your headstone? Would you write it down? See, Alex didn't tell me that. Alex still does not have a headstone. That is the last thing that I will get to do for Alex. Just already. So what do you want on your headstone, guys? Because there's nothing your parents can put on your headstone that's going to tell the world when they walk by and see that headstone that tells the world how much they loved you. How beautiful you were to them. How can I put on a headstone that I learned more from Alex in 17 years than she ever learned from me? How can I tell the world how big her heart was that she walked into a room and smiled and made people happy? How did your parents put that on yours? I just want you to think. There's so many wonderful things to experience out there. And I want you to be right there in the middle of all of it. Being the leader and being awesome and amazing. Because that's what you've been designed and created to be. And the next time you're in your car and you're driving along, that cell phone goes off, as you reach for it out of habit, because I know you do. Because I did for a long time, even after Alex died. As you reach for it, you stop yourself because you think, you know what? I'm more important than that. And I choose to be here for my future. Thank y'all so much for listening. Y'all have been a wonderful audience. And I'm always honored to be able to talk to our future leaders of our country. Thank you so much and God bless you.
That's Mrs. Jeanne Brown from the RAB, Remember Alex Brown. Thank you so much. Our next speaker is Jay Foerster. Jay has been a firefighter and paramedic with Lubbock Fire and Rescue for 13 years. and has spent 22 years in EMS. He was the medical operations officer for Lubbock Fire and Rescue for 2.5 years. He has worked all over the region, including Bailey County, EMS, as a paramedic. He has been teaching new EMTs for 15 years. Please welcome Mr. Jay Foerster.
I want to say hello. I want you to know that I do this on my own time. I'm not sponsored by Lubbock Fire. I'm not sponsored by anybody. I drove down here in my own pickup with my own diesel to speak to you guys. So I would just ask that you listen, and maybe one of you, and that's all I need is one, maybe one of you will think before you do. And I had a hard time back there listening to Ms. Brown. I'm not gonna lie about it. 22 years of EMS experience, and I've seen a lot of it. There's things that I hope you guys never see that these eyes have seen. And a lot of it is decisions that people make that cost them their lives, cost their family members their lives, their friends. And there are accidents, but there are preventable accidents also. So I'm going to talk to y'all about a call that I ran when I was the director of EMS in Castro County. It's much like Bailey County. A lot of rural area, a couple of small towns. The kids can look around and they know pretty much everybody in the room, right? Just like here. The young kids know the old kids. The freshmen go party with the seniors, right? If they let them, right? Okay. Yeah. It's much like that. I grew up down the road, one of y'all's rivals in shallow water. I know, ooh, right. So I've sat in these seats. I've heard these talks. And I've been where you've been, right? I can promise you there's a place that you guys know, your parents probably know it too, where you guys go and you get away from the guys with the badges so you don't get caught, you don't get in trouble. I'm not going to ask you where it's at. I can promise you the guys with the badges probably already know where it's at, and they're probably sitting there waiting for y'all to come from there. If I can, I'm going to have the lights dimmed. Maybe a little more dimmed. It's still pretty light in here. That's okay. We'll work with what we got. Guys, I want to tell you about a wreck that I ran. And when you've heard these people talk, Ms. Brown talked, you heard Mr. Brown talk. promise you I can pull 100 first responders up here and they'll tell you the same thing. There are calls that we run that we can close our eyes and we can see very vividly. There's things that haunt us at night. There's been nights that I've come home and I crawl in bed with my kids and just hug them. I had to leave the room probably 10 or 12 times today. Because every time I hear a story, it puts me back in some calls that I've had to tell the parents. I did everything I could do. There was nothing else I could do. I gave it my all. And I relive some of those. And I relive some of those a lot. In 22 years of seeing things, it haunts you. And I'm going to tell you about one call that I ran that haunts me. I was the director of EMS. So my pager sat beside my bed at my house. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. My radio was always right there. I was pretty much on call all the time if something major happened. I had a paramedic and his partner. He was an EMT basic that at night, usually our basics, that they were some of our, we weren't really volunteer, they were paid, but they got to stay at the house because they lived there. Most of my paramedics came in from out of town. And I tried to hire the best of the best. Because they have to stand alone out there on their own without any help. So you can't have somebody that doesn't know what they're doing or just learning to do this. You have to have somebody that's a seasoned paramedic out there. Well, Chris, he was a seasoned paramedic. He's one of those guys that's been there, has done that, got the t-shirt for it, if you know what I mean. He's the kind of guy that he'll roll up on there, and if you've got this arm that's hanging off, broke, dangling, he goes, I can fix that. That doesn't bother me. I know what to do. And he was my paramedic that was on duty. At 5:30 in the morning, my pager goes off. What comes across that pager says, EMS, be advised, we have a one car rollover, multiple victims. Give you more on the radio. So I turned my radio on. I got up, knowing that it had multiple victims, right? I started putting on my pants, finding me a t-shirt, started waking up. I got on the radio and dispatch comes across and they give the address or a location of where this wreck was supposed to have happened. When that went on, my paramedic and his partner, they started in the ambulance and they started getting around. And right as they were fixing to call around, dispatch comes across and said, I've got a couple of victims from the wreck that are headed in a private vehicle to the courthouse. And so I answered up and told Chris, I said, go ahead and go to the scene. I'll go ahead and go to the courthouse. And during that time period, I had gotten one of my other guys up from his sleep and said, hey, meet me at the station. get the other ambulance and we need to go to the courthouse. So I met him at the station. We pulled the ambulance out and we headed to the courthouse. And we pulled up there and it was probably maybe 30 seconds to a minute. And a big four-door, four-wheel drive diesel pickup pulls up. And in the front seat is this young man. He's 16 years old. Two other young men were in the back seat. And I walked up to the passenger seat and I was like, what happened? And this young man says, nothing. Not much of emotion, just kind of like, nothing happened. Well, I kind of looked at him, you know, it's kind of a low light. It's probably even more dark than what it is right now. Had the cab light inside and I could notice there was just some, it looked like burns that was coming up kind of from his collar. And I said, hey man, did you get burned? And he goes, oh, I didn't get burned. I was like, those look like burns to me. He says, I was thinking, were you jumping through a campfire, you know, what was going on? And the kids in the back seat chimed in and said, we were at the Foerster and we were coming back and we had a wreck. I said, okay. I said, well, how did he get burned? And they go, we don't know. All right. So I went ahead and I said, all right, y'all are going to go. We're going to go to the hospital and get it checked out. So the two young men that were in the back seat went ahead and got out. I said, why don't y'all just jump up there in the jump seat and on the bench seat. And the other young man that was in the passenger seat, I got him out of the vehicle. And I said, well, without us knowing how you got burned and this and that, I said, we're going to go ahead and put you on a board. And I pulled the cot out, we put him on our backboard, and we started doing our spinal mobilization. And as I was loading him in the back of the ambulance, the radio chimed in. And on the other end of that radio was Chris, and he'd gotten on the scene. And all Chris said was, Jay, get out here now. I said, received. And I went ahead and loaded up that young man in the back of the ambulance. The courthouse to the hospital is about 3 or 4 blocks. I was just trying to get information from these kids on what was going on because I knew that Chris was a very seasoned medic and he did not get flustered. And I could hear it in his voice as he came across the radio that he had more than he could handle. I called the hospital and I told him, I said, meet me on the ramp, bring me a hospital bed, meet me on the ramp. I've got 3 patients. One of them's going to be immobilized. So they met me on the ramp and I transferred the kid that was on the backboard over to the hospital bed. The other two, I told them to go ahead and walk on through the ER and had a couple of nurses that met them there and they took them in. And I said, I got to go. I said, okay. As I pulled up out there on scene, this is out 6-7 miles out in the county. As I pull up out there on scene, my partner looks over at me and he goes, Jay, is this a mock drill? You know, you've seen these mock drills that the Shattered Dreams program does where we dress you up and we try to make it as gory and as nasty as we possibly can to make an impact, right? He says, is this a mock drill? And, you know, doing this as long as I have, and we have our protection mechanisms and stuff, so we kind of have a sick sense of humor sometimes. And I said, dude, you know me, I like my sleep as much as anybody. said, I ain't going to get you up at 5:30 in the morning to come out here in a coffin. I said, we got to get to work. So I jump out, and I meet Chris, and I said, man, what you got? And he says, I've got two dead. He said, I've got multiple injuries. I'm not even sure exactly how many I have yet. He said, I'm still trying to figure it out. And I said, all right, man. I said, you go that way, and I'll go this way, and we'll meet in the middle. So as I'm walking and trying to assess these kids that are out here in this cotton field, I have one young man that is pulling himself with his front arms, dragging the bottom part of his torso. You've seen it like on these zombies movies, you know, where you got these zombies that are just crawling, you know, trying to come get you. That's what this young man was doing. He was dragging the lower half of his body in the cotton field, coming towards me. And as he's coming towards me, he is yelling at the top of his lungs, help me! Please! Please help me! Help me! I want you to think about that. This young man is crawling, pulling himself through the dirt, screaming for help. One of the hardest things we have to learn in EMS is you have to transport patients that are most viable. We have to do the most for the most, right? We have to take care of the ones that are viable, and the ones that may not survive may still be alive, but they may not survive. And we know those injuries that may not survive, we have to pass them over to take the ones that we know will survive. It's what we call triage. So I had to tell this young man, stop, I'll be right back. I've still got to figure out what all I've got. This young man is crawling towards me the whole time while I'm trying to figure out what's going on this scene. Because I've got people strode out all over the place. And he's yelling at the top of his lungs, help me, please, just please help me. So this young man, while he's doing all this, I'm trying to figure out what's going on. I finally finished, and me and Chris met in the middle. So this is what I've got. Well, I come to find out that young man that was been following me around, screaming and hollering, help me, was the patient that needed my most help. So I told my partner, I said, go grab a backboard, and I said, meet me back over here. And I started to assess this young man. I told him, I said, roll over. And I started to assess him, and I said, we were going to get the backboard. And as we were going to put him on the backboard, I grabbed him at the knees while my partner grabbed him up on the shoulders, and we were going to put him on the backboard. And when I grabbed him at the knees, both of his legs rainbowed around my hand. They felt like jelly. There was no structure whatsoever in the lower extremities from his knees down. None. The bones were so fractured that they just rainbowed around my hands. And even I'm a seasoned medic, and I'm like, whoa, it took back. I was like, that's not supposed to happen. That's not right. So I load him on that cot. And I put him in the back of the ambulance. Well, when you have a limited amount of personnel and you have a limited amount of ambulances, kind of like Bailey County here, I
think they have three now. That's what I had up there. I had three ambulances. And the next closest ambulance is going to come from like Olden or Hereford. And it's going to be 30 minutes to 45 minutes before I can get another ambulance there. So I called the hospital and I said, you need to send me every bird you got. And by what a bird is every helicopter that's around. If they'll send a helicopter, send them. So Amarillo sent a helicopter, and Lubbock sent two of their helicopters from AeroCare. And I have to notify them early because I'm out in the middle of the county. I've got multiple patients, and they're critical. And I know that time is of essence. One of the things I teach is we call it the golden hour. It's from the time you get hurt to the time you get the surgeon's knife. Not to the time we get there, not to the time we get you to the ER. It's the time you get surgery and are under the surgeon's knife. We call it the golden hour. And a lot of times if you don't meet that golden hour, the patient's survivability goes down drastically. Well, let me tell you when this wreck happened. This wreck happened about 2 a.m. 2 to 2:30 is what they're estimating. These kids laid out there in the cotton field, fresh plowed cotton field in the dark. This is really a lot of light compared to what it was. And they laid there listening to this young man scream. They laid there listening to everybody moaning and groaning. That could. So I want you to imagine sitting there in the middle of a cotton field. The temperature was pretty close to what it is today. Laying out there with some of your really good friends. Really good friends. Listening to one of them screaming and hollering at the top of their lungs, help me, please, somebody help me. These kids didn't know that was going to happen, right? Would you have thought that? This was after the first scrimmage of the year. First football scrimmage of the year. What had happened is that they were all out here and they called this place the Foerster. You know, in West Texas, it's not real prevalent to have a lot of trees, right? Okay. Well, this was a group of trees out in the middle of a cotton field, out in the middle of nowhere. I mean, literally out in the middle of nowhere. It's just a group of trees. And what they've done is gone in there and they'd hollowed out the middle of it. And so they had a campfire and that's where they all went to party. Much like probably where y'all know where you go party, right? That's why I was thinking this kid probably fell through the campfire. Because I thought, you know, hey, you see these YouTube videos, right? Where the kids are, you know, or somebody's, you know, getting really sauced up. Getting drunk, and they think, hey, I'm going to walk the fire, you know, whatever. And I thought he fell into it. And I'm going to tell you what happened to him in a second. I loved this young man. I put him in the back of the ambulance, and I was fighting him to try to get an IV in his arm. Because the kid had had a head injury. He wasn't thinking right. And he's fighting me this whole time. And I'm not a small guy. But when somebody's trying to fight you and you're trying to stick a sharp object in their arm, it's kind of a difficult situation. And I didn't have any help because of the fact that I had so many people that were involved in this wreck that my partner was out taking care of other patients. So I hollered out the back of the ambulance because the doors were open. I said, give me one more patient and let's go. all along while I'm trying to fight this young man, I got an IV in him. And I put one of those IVs that's about the size of a coffee straw in his arm. Because he had been laying out there for 3 hours and he was in shock for sure, right? This kid might not survive the ride to the hospital. While I'm doing that, I tell him, let's go, right? So my partner, they load another kid up and they put him in there with me. And he's one of those kids that really probably, normal cases would get probably all of my attention. But in this case, this young man that I'm fighting with is going to have my sole attention. I'm not going to be able to do much with the other kid they load up. So I told them, don't give me a critical patient. Give me somebody that can just basically ride till I can maybe get a set of vital signs on them. This young man pulls that IV out as I'm headed into the hospital. I mean, yanks it out of his arm because he's not thinking of it. So he's got this hole in his arm the size of a coffee straw and it's just spewing blood. And I've got to get another one because he's got to have an IV. He's got to have fluid. I've got to replace what he's lost already. I've got to do what it takes to get this kid to survive. So I managed to get another IV in him, and I basically held him so he couldn't pull it out all the way to the hospital. As we unload, I said, this kid, I said, do y'all have a helicopter? And they were like, yeah, Amarillo just landed. I said, well, have them meet me in the, I said, I'll meet them on the pad. So I entered through the ER, and I didn't even go into the ER. I just stayed in the hallway, and we went straight down the hallway. Well, the flight crew was coming up the hallway at that time. I said, he's going with you guys. I gave him a short rundown. And one of the nurses said, hey, I know this kid. His grandma's is one of the nurses down there in the other wing, in the south wing. I've got to get her. And I was like, guys, I don't know if we're going to wait. He needs to be going, I mean, like, muy pronto. Right? He needs to be gone. We can't be sitting here twiddling our thumbs in the hallway. And so they run. I mean, I'm talking mad sprint. As mad sprint as a 40-year-old woman can do. Okay? She's mad sprints down there, and she gets grandma. And this is grandma because this kid stayed with grandma. She had custody of him. I don't know what the situation was, but she's all the way. I can hear her coming down. She goes, nah, it's not him. It can't be him. He called me at midnight and said he was at home. How many of you called and said, hey, I'm at home and aren't really there? Or, hey, I'm at a friend's house and you're not really there? I don't want to show of hands. You think about it, this young man called his grandmother because that was his parental being and said, hey, I'm at home. And at 5:30 in the morning, you find out, hey, he wasn't at home and now he's fighting for his life. This young man is fighting, I mean, literally fighting for his life. And she's going, it can't be. It just can't. He called me at midnight. It can't be him. Oh my God! What did you do? What happened? What have you done? Can you feel the emotion that's going on right now? I'm like, hey, we need to send him, or he may not make it. We need to let him go now. So they loaded him and they put him on the helicopter, and whew, they were off. as I was walking back, the charge nurse catches me and she says, "Hey man, did you get to look at that kid that had the burns?" And I said, "No." I said, "I just saw the burns coming out of his collar." She goes, "He's got second and third degree burns from the waist up." I said, "How the hell did that happen?" Excuse my language. And I was like, how did that happen? She goes, "I don't know. And we've got him intubated. We've got a tube down his throat. We're breathing for him. The helicopter's fixing to land. And guess what? They're going to send him to the burn unit in Lubbock." But my job's not done, guys. Because I have to load back up and I have to go back out there to the scene because I've still got patients that are laying out in the cotton field. So me and my partner, we head back out there. And luckily, I had a couple of paramedics that lived in town and they had showed up on the scene. And my main ambulance that Chris was in, it actually would haul four patients. You hung two from the ceiling on backboards and two, one on the bench seat, one on the cot. And they had three critical patients and one that was not as critical, and they were fixing to transport as soon as I showed up. When I got there, I loaded one patient up and I came to the hospital. It wasn't that critical because those are the ones that are going to have to just sit there. He had a broken ankle. I got to talking to find out what exactly went on because, I mean, it was so chaotic. Nobody knew what had happened. We just knew that it was a car wreck, right? What had happened and talking to the young men that were in the wreck and after finding out what exactly had happened, there was nine of them that were still out there at the forest in the trees and that had gotten left, and there was nobody to bring them back home. Everybody had left, no ride. So what they did is they called their buddy. Their buddy had already gone home, taken his girlfriend home. He was at the house. They said, "Hey man, Jake, can you come get us?" Jake's like, "Man, I'm at home. We don't have anybody else to come get us." He goes, yeah. "I'll be there in a second." So what did Jake do? Much like what anybody would do for their friend, he snuck out, right? Sneak out, get my pickup, haul butt. So he hauls butt out there to the, "Y'all get in, come on, hurry. Gotta get back before I get caught." They estimated Jake doing over 90 miles an hour on a county Cleachy road. He hit a dip in the road and he lost control. There was four of them in the front seat and six in the bed of the pickup. This was estimated 2:30 in the morning. Jake had been out. He'd been out there. He'd been partying with them. They said, yes, he had been drinking. I don't know if he was drunk or not. He had been drinking. He made the decision to try to go help his friends. That decision cost two of them their lives and changed the rest of them from here on. After everything was said and done, we cleared that scene from time to finish in an hour and 15 minutes is how long it took us to transport all those patients to the hospital. That is record time. Record time. I took Jake because he had what we call a basilar skull fracture. His front of his face and the back of his skull had been fractured in the wreck. And I took him to Lubbock. And the whole way to Lubbock, he kept saying, "I wish I'd died. I wish I'd just died." And talking to the kids that were out there that were still on scene, the ones that didn't walk, they said that he kept saying that he laid in the bed of the pickup after everything was said and done. He walked around to check on everybody as much as he could, and he kept saying, "I wish I had died." There was a 17-year-old young woman that was sitting in the driver's seat when the wreck happened, whenever it stopped. When all the chaos stopped, she was in the front seat, and the cab had been closed down on top of her. She was dead. They covered her up with a sheet. 17. I want you to think about that. That was her senior year. The start of her senior year. Supposed to be one of the happy times, right? Think about you guys that are sitting here as seniors. You're going, "Man, I'm almost out of here." This was the start of that year. It's supposed to be great. Not as many classes. You get to kind of go jack around more, right? It's party time. This is the year that, hey, it's going to be a good year, right? She didn't get to do that. Her dad did not get to walk her down the aisle. Think about that. Her mom and dad never got to see her have her first child, their first grandbaby. I've got a 14-year-old daughter. She's a freshman at Shotwater. And it scares me to death, guys. Scares me to death. Because they made a decision that night to get in a pickup, haul butt, and it cost two of them their lives. Casey, 16-year-old, big guy. He's one of the high school linemen. He was a sophomore starting on varsity football. He's a big, burly guy. They said they could hear him breathing for a while. And then it stopped. He was laying in the bar ditch. He took his last breath in that bar ditch. 16 years old. And we go back and I think, you know, what if, right? We armchair quarterback. What if they had called us at 2:35. What if I'd gotten called out at 3 o'clock? The young man probably would have survived because he probably sat there and drowned in his own blood. His lungs probably filled up and he drowned in his own blood. That's not a way to go, guys. It's surely not a way to go at 16. I can close my eyes and I can still see Stacy's face and Casey's face right now. I can still see their bodies. I covered up Stacy with a white sheet. And I walked down and had to cover up Casey with a white sheet. And they were the last ones to leave that scene. Cut her out of that vehicle. It took them 45 minutes to cut her out. And it was a decision each and every one of those kids made that night. Each and every one of them says, "Hey, I'm getting in that pickup and going." They They didn't think, hey, you know, old Jake, he's been drinking. I don't know how much he's been drinking, but you know what? Hey, I'm getting in that pickup. It will be all right, right? But I mean, I can tell you, I've been there. I thought the same thing. Yeah, I'll be all right. I drove with some people that I go, man, I'm surprised. I'm lucky to be alive, right? I know if each and every one of you have been there too. But the thing is these kids were not that lucky. And I know you guys have got your prom coming up this weekend, right? Let me tell you something. If you will call your parents, if you get, because I know, I grew up in a small town. I know what's going to go on. I know the after parties. And the after parties. Right? Okay. But if you get in a situation, you can't drive, your driver can't drive, your boyfriend, your girlfriend, whoever's driving can't drive, make an adult decision and call someone. I don't care if it's a brother or a sister, just somebody that's sober, that somebody that's responsible, and say, come get me. My daughter knows that it doesn't matter what is going on, that she can call me and there will be no questions asked. Because I want to walk her down the aisle. I want to see her have her first child. I want to see her tomorrow. Guys, it's tough. It's tough every time I come up here and talk to you. Because I have to relive this every time. I have to go over it in my mind every time. And if they had made that decision, at least one of them said, hey, I'm going to call my brother, I'm going to call my mom, my dad, somebody to come get them, other than somebody that was going to get in trouble, that was having to haul butt, then they would all be alive right now. I wouldn't have to see their mom and dads every day around town. Jake would never have to see every one of their parents and see some of those kids that was in that wreck every day. Because he relives that tragic day every day of his life. And it's just like the Brown said, every time that they pass by the crosses on the road and the flowers and the little things spark. Little things spark those memories. But if you make that call, you won't be a memory. You'll be the here and now, right? If you make a call and make an adult decision, you'll be the here and now, not a memory. You won't be a picture on a screen. And that's what I want to bring to you guys. If you go home, you know who you can call. I mean, some of you got what we call cool parents, right? But you know that, hey, I can call them, right? Because I can promise you my daughter's friends know that they can call me. I don't care if I'm at the fire station, if I'm at the EMS station, if I'm at my home in my bed. If my phone is on 24/7 and if that phone rings and they say, I need you to come get me, I'll ask where. And I'm getting in and I'm going. Because I don't want to ever have to look at another parent's face and say, I did everything I could, but it wasn't good enough. don't want to do that. It's not worth it to me. So that's why I drive in my own diesel, in my own pickup, on my own time to come deliver a message to you guys. Call somebody. I'm not telling you, don't do it. Yeah, it's probably not the smartest thing to do. But you know what? We're going to make decisions. We're going to make decisions that affect our lives. We're going to make bad decisions. We're going to learn from those bad decisions. But if you make a decision to do the right thing, even though you've made a bad decision, it'll pay off in the end. I've talked to some of the kids that had younger siblings, just like this video here. It's tragic. And I can just imagine, and that's why I had to leave the room, because I can just see my daughter up here. My daughter's blonde hair, blue eyes, it looks so similar. And I have a 9-year-old son, and I can just see him in tears talking about his sister. Because he loves her to death. And I don't know if he'd ever survive. I know I won't. I don't know if I can handle it. And I'm speaking to you as somebody here that's done this, and I'm speaking to you as a parent. It's not worth it, guys. It's not worth it. Make the phone call. Get somebody that's a designated driver. Somebody that's not going to go out and partake. Because I know that you're probably going to. Just don't make the decision to try to get behind that wheel after you've done it. Because you put everybody on that road at risk. And you may be the one that doesn't come home. You may be the one that DPS comes to the door and knocks on the door and says, "Are you Mr. and Mrs.? He or she's not coming home tonight. Did you have a fight this morning with your parents? Did you have a fight yesterday? What was the last words you said to them? Did you leave and say, I love you? Think about that. Every day I leave to go to the fire station, I make a point in kissing my daughter, my son, and my wife, and I tell them I love them, because that might be the last time I get to. Think about that. Did you have a fight with your sibling? Were you in an argument this morning? Were you fighting over the mirror? Is that the last thing that they remember? Those are things you've got to think about. And I'm not trying to put the gloom and all that on you, but I do want you to think about some of those things, because if it just spurs you and says, hey, maybe I ought to call somebody real quick. Instead of somebody calling and saying, they're not coming home. We can turn, well, you can leave lights down, but I want to show you the wreck scene. And there's a lot of pictures in this wreck scene that I can't show you. See that pickup? It looks real familiar, doesn't it? When I saw Ms. Brown, when I pulled up shortly after she did, and I saw that pickup, I went, oh man, There were six kids in the bed of that pickup. You see that telephone pole? They sheared it off 2 foot from the ground. That's how hard they hit that telephone pole. Remember I told you about that young man that had the burns? When they hit that pole, he went up through the lines and landed out in the cotton field. It arced. That's where he got second and third degree burns. One of the kids that was out there that couldn't walk to town gave him his t-shirt and said, here, because it had burned his shirt off of him. Can you imagine laying out there for 3 hours, pitch dark, about the same temperature it is right now? But if they had called somebody, said, come get me, other than somebody that had been out there partying with them, they'd be alive today. Guys, I appreciate y'all letting me come out and visit with you. Like I said, if I can just get one of you to think, hey, it's not worth it, let me make a phone call. Let me call somebody. I'm sure there's some administrators here, some of your teachers, that I promise you they'll make that pledge that if you call them, they'll probably come get you. Because I made my kids after this wreck, I made my kids at Dimmitt High School, I said, you know what, if you need me, you call me. I'll come get you in the ambulance. I'll come get you in my pickup. I don't care what it is. I don't ever run a wreck like this. It's not worth it. It changed the community. Because the first responders that showed up are the volunteers, the same ones like here at Muleshoe. Same guys, they're your brothers, your sisters, your dads, moms, aunts, uncles. How do you think they would respond to seeing you laying out under a sheet? We lost half the fire department on that wreck. Half the volunteer fire department on that wreck we lost that day. They can't do it. I understand. So guys, this weekend, not just this weekend, every day, if you go out, you have a party, you have a good time, make sure you have some way to make sure you get home. A responsible way to get home. Appreciate y'all letting me come out. If you have any questions, I'll be at the back of the room after. I'll gladly visit with you.
People are going to the prom Saturday night. What we want from this is not only now, but in the future, we want this to be the safest, funnest prom you've ever had. But the key word is safe. We want everybody to be safe. I really appreciate Jeanne Brown and Jay Foerster. Let's show them some love with one more big round.